So, as I mentioned into last stanza when I was discussing it, I told you that John Keats is rich in sensuousness. He uses imagery to arouse a special effect, and with that use of imagery, John Keats has shown a special dexterity skill into creating beauty of the object that he is describing into his poems. Okay, now let us move to the world of Nightingale that John Keats is describing and try to understand what further said John Keats in the poem. Now, as you might be remembering that it was the moment of night, and he described the world of the nightingale as he was guessing, because he could not see perhaps the things that he wanted to, and he could not smell correctly the fragrance of the flower. So he was guessing. He mentioned in the third line of the fifth stanza that he guesses each and every object. Now, he wants to see that the world of nightingale and the world of human beings is different. He has known it and he has seen it. So now he is going to talk to the bird. Earlier in five stanzas, you might have not seen that the poet is trying to establish a direct communication with the bird Nightingale. But in this stanza, you will see, "Darkling, I listen." It means that now he is being aware of the fact that the Nightingale is singing something and John Keats is listening it. So one kind of communication is happening when John Keats is going to listen what the Nightingale is going to tell or going to sing. "Darkling, I listen." Darkling means things in the dark. It means that the darkness is outspread, and it has perhaps two meanings. One is the moment of the night that you have already seen into the previous stanza. At the same time, when something is darkling, it is not that much clear. Okay, so here in first, I think John Keats means the first meaning, in the dark. So in the dark, he is listening what, "And for many a time I have been half in love with deathful ease." He has heard the song of nightingale in the time of darkness, in the time of night especially. And after listening the song of the nightingale, what John Keats feels like, "And for many a time," he is saying that not one time, he has felt many times. And every time when he listens to the song of the nightingale, he finds the same experience. And what is the experience like? Like he had been half in love with the easeful death. There are two, you can say, a pair of words. One that I have underlined is half in love, and the second, easeful death. See, what is the meaning of half in love? Not being totally in love. It means that John Keats is perhaps aware of his own identity in this stanza. He is not totally in the world of Nightingale. So he is half in love, not completely in love with the song of the nightingale. Or when he is going to describe death, he has also felt that he wanted to die. You might have also noticed when I was discussing his personal life, this was the time when John Keats was, not so happy with his life. His brother passed away, he also had contracted tuberculosis. So John Keats perhaps felt that he is going to die, but he did not want to die because another woman, Fanny Brawne, she came into his life. So maybe he was half in love with death, that he was going to die because of the incurable disease he was suffering from, or he was in love with the woman. So half in love, maybe what John Keats means, I am not getting to it, but this might be the interpretation. And what is easeful death? A death that does not have pain. So is it possible that death would be easeful? Death is painful. People don't want to die. But John Keats is saying that he had been off time, or he had been many a time in love, if not completely half in love. With what? With death. It means that John Keats felt that he was going to die perhaps, but he wanted that this death should not be painful. It should be easeful. It should be happiest joyous. It should not be as painful as people describe it. And this death has been called him of names in many amused rhymes. And there are so many poems. Muse rhymes means musical rhymes, musical poems, musical songs. So muse rhymes means poems and songs both. And he is saying that though death is painful object, and if you go to the logic of personification, death is already written to capital letter. So when any harsh, strong, painful object is described, it is turned into male. When soft, beautiful object is described, it is turned into female. And now he has already shown you that death has been referred to as male object. But this death has not been described as painful in many amused rhymes. It means that there are so many poems which have described death in painful way, like it is very strong, very unpleasant object. But there are other poets, or many other poets, who have described this particular concept death into pleasant way. Okay, so that is what he is telling, that death has been called with soft names in many amused rhymes, to take into the air my quiet breath. And if this kind of death, perhaps the easeful death, the soft name that is given to this death, if it is coming to John Keats, he would like to die. Because death does what? Death takes your breath into air, and you cannot breathe in and breathe out, so you die. So John Keats is perhaps referring to this moment, that after listening to the song of the nightingale, and in this utter darkness when he was not able to see anything, smell anything, taste anything, just he is guessing, he finds this moment perhaps very suitable to die. And this moment will be easeful moment, because this nightingale is singing, so he is already half in the world of nightingale. Maybe this is what John Keats is trying to say when he is saying half in love. And then he will not feel that much pain as he might be feeling when he is totally in the real world of human beings. So he wants to die at this moment so that he will not feel pain, and his breath will be smoothly and pleasantly, happily taken away from him. And now he is going to describe this idea further into the lines, like he says, now more than ever seems it risk to die. And here the feeling of death that John Keats has is becoming quite intense. John Keats is feeling that it is more than ever seems it risk to die. He finds that this is the better moment, if not the best, as compared to the previous moments in his life. John Keats, while listening the song of the nightingale at the time of night, he find this moment more accurate, more rich to die. That is why he is saying, now more than ever seems it rich to die, to seize upon the midnight with no pain. And at this moment, to seize means to stop happening, to stop existing. So he is saying that the breath that he is taking and the air that he is taking in and taking out, it is going to stop, if it is going to stop at this moment, in this midnight, and if there is no pain because he is in the world of nightingale, it would be really a good time. So he wants to seize, he wants to die upon this midnight, upon the moment when he is describing, or this stanza is stuck in, and he does not want to feel pain. Now you compare this the first line of this poem with this idea, when he is saying that drowsy numbness pains. He is in the world of nightingale and he has little bit pain, but he is also feeling numbed. So anyhow you might be observing that the idea is perhaps getting connected here. He is coming to the point which he was describing in the first stanza. So why he would be half in love, why the death is easeful and why he is going to die in the midnight and there will be no pain because he is in the world of nightingale. While thou art pouring forth thy soul abroad. And who is thou? This is nightingale. And he's saying that even at this moment when John Keats is going to die, the nightingale will be singing. And what will it be doing? It would be pouring forth her own soul. It means she will be singing throughout. Abroad in such an ecstasy. Ecstasy means joy, the greatest point of happiness which you feel. And this would be also the time of greatest happiness for John Keats, because when John Keats is going to die, a bird is singing. And the bird is not an ordinary bird, this is a legendary bird, nightingale. Immortal bird, he has already referred to this word in the previous stanza. And it would be good for John Keats to die, and he will find that he has received the greatest happiness of life and he has lived in ecstasy. Still wouldest thou sing and I have ears in vain. What is the meaning of ears in vain? He will have ears, but he will not be listening. See, the idea is that when John Keats is going to die and this nightingale is singing, John Keats will die, though his dead body will have ears, but he will not hear the song of the nightingale. And now he further says, to thy high requiem become a sod. Requiem is the death song that this nightingale is singing. When John Keats will die, the pleasant song of the nightingale will become the mournful song for John Keats. People will believe that John Keats died at the moment and the bird nightingale was mourning on the death of John Keats. See how he has transformed the representation of nightingale from being a bird which brings happiness, brings calmness, peace into the mind of the listener, heart of the listener, to the bird being a mourner, a person who is going to mourn on the death of John Keats. It means that John Keats, when he will die, while listening the song of the nightingale, what people will assume? People will assume that on the death of John Keats, nightingale mourned and sang a, you can say, sad song. And what he is now saying, he is saying that this song, the requiem that this bird is going to sing, it will become a sod. It will become a grave, perhaps, in which the dead memories, dead body of John Keats will be encaptured, it will be buried forever. Whenever people will listen to the song of the nightingale, people might be aware that this is the bird nightingale that sang on the death of John Keats. So this is what John Keats is perhaps trying to say in this stanza. Okay.